So computers and networks and hardware are incredibly valuable, and they make our lives wonderful, and they allow us to do tremendous things. But we have to be cognizant of where that information is going, what that information can do, and this technology allows us to talk, to peer into the future, and to look at what behaviors the systems are capable of. And then allows us to fix those unwanted behaviors in the system ahead of time. So it allows us to proactively look at possible behaviors of hardware or software.
Byron Cook is a distinguished scientist and vice president at AWS. Byron has been working in the field of formal verification for over 20 years and has made several major research contributions over his career. He's also developed influential tools which have been applied to a wider range of topics, from programming language and operating systems to reasoning about biological systems and genetic regulatory pathways. This work has been used to answer some fundamental questions that no other tool was able to solve before. For example, pharmaceutical companies use this technology to better understand leukemia and find new treatment options for the disease. At AWS, Byron leads a team of domain experts developing formal verification tools for a wide variety of problems, helping to keep the cloud safe and secure and to protect our customers. Even though Byron has been working in the field since the late 90s, automated reasoning is still considered to be an emerging technology. I was curious to learn more, so I met with Byron to dive deeper on the kinds of applications that he and his teams are exploring today. Now, you might be wondering, what is formal verification and how does it work?
Formal verification, generally speaking, is automated reasoning applied to problems back in computers. So automated reasoning is the algorithmic search for proofs in mathematical logic. And then when we apply automated reasoning back to algorithms, to hardware, to software systems, then that's typically called formal verification.
To put it in simple terms, formal verification is the use of mathematical logic to prove properties of systems. We use formal verification to prove things about all the possible configurations a computer program might reach. Byron's ambition at the AWS Automatic Reasoning Group is to automate all of the reasoning performed during formal verification.
Imagine you wanted to prove that zero is less than one across the entire Linux kernel. Super easy to do. You go to every line of the code and you say, is zero less than one? Yes, it is true, right? It's true. It's a tautology. So it's true. So I can in a very scalable way, proved zero is less than one across all the world's code, no problem. Now, let me just take a slightly more interesting question. Is X less than Y? So now what you need to do is you look for all the places where stack variables X and Y are in scope. And typically X and Y won't be in scope in the Linux kernel. So now it's only gonna be a few places you have variables named X and Y, and both X and Y. And now you need to do a little bit of reasoning in that code to do it. So this is an example of, if you're asking a simple question of sophisticated large amounts of code, it's actually quite easy. And so then the question of what is it you're asking of the model that's been either developed by a developer or that's been synthesized via methods such as machine learning, it's really the question you're asking of the system that drives how challenging that is. So the idea is we encode the system as a set of constraints in mathematical logic. And then you use same techniques that have been around for hundreds of years. For example, we might reason about the validity of the Pythagorean theorem. You know, you find a finite argument in mathematical logic about what is true about an infinite set. So we can use those same techniques to reason about the intractably large or infinite set of states of a system. So a microprocessor design, or a piece of software, for example. So we reuse the sort of key idea is to use the idea of mathematical induction, where you reason about all possible time and all possible states that a system could enter via a couple of steps.
When we are talking about mathematical logic, some folks might think about some obscure theory, not necessarily of practical applications. But Byron has managed to balance the tension between theory and the practical problems our industry faces.
So there's this great quote by Strachey, who founded the Oxford Computer Science Department. And I'm going to get the quote a little, I don't have it memorized, but it's something to the effect of, the division between theory and practice in computing is injurious to our field. That theoreticians don't know what to work on, and practitioners don't know what they're doing. And so what you the real magic is when you combine, when you're working at the intersection of theory and practice. So what I've found in my career is that coming from a theoretical perspective, I realized that, for example, termination was a very practical concern, and there were very practical techniques that I could bring to the tools to answer questions that developers had about their systems.
So let's talk about termination. What does that mean in this context? Well, termination is program analysis that attempts to determine whether the evaluation of a given program holds for each input.
Basically, the termination is a, like, does the, uses the word eventually. So will the program eventually terminate? Will the program eventually release the lock? So will the device driver eventually give control back to the operating system? Will the biological system, when perturbed, eventually stabilize back to a good known state? So that's termination. Systems are usually developed with an event loop, and whenever you press a key, you touch your screen, network packet comes in. There's event handling code designed to handle that event, and one would hope eventually stop handling the event. So typically, there's an action to be taken. You go through some data structures. You look something up. You put something. You remove something, and then the job of that event handling code is to exit, and typically when you don't exit, that hangs the system or doesn't respond, and so that turns out to be a common pattern that for all kinds of reasons that we want to show of systems.
Byron joined AWS in 2015 with a mission to draw his theoretical work out of his research papers and develop real-world practical applications for automated reasoning. So how is this being applied today?
So basically, I wanted in 2015 timeframe to walk away a couple of years later with a couple of successes where automated reasoning really moved the needle in some way for customers and for AWS. So we basically made four bets. So one of them was to apply to take policies and the semantics of the resource policy language, and encode that into mathematical logic, and then use off-the-shelf open source automated theorem provers to answer questions about them. So that's Zelkova. And Zelkova has gone on to power S3 block public access. It's gone on to power IAM Access Analyzer, IoT Device Defender. There are some config managed rules that use Zelkova. Macy uses Zelkova, Guard Duty uses Zelkova, the list goes on. So that was one of the bets. The next one was, let's do the same thing, but for networks that customers are building on top of EC2, so VPCs, for example. Let's say, I'm not sure the exact number, but let's say 50 to 100 networking concepts, virtualized networking concepts that customers use and put together to build virtual networks. And then there's questions often around reachability of, can this instance connect to this database? Can this instance connect to this other instance? Under what conditions can it connect? Or often you want instances to not be able to connect. So we take the customer network design, essentially using Describe API calls. we have in mathematical logic the semantics of EC2 networking that we've written, and then we have a question we want to ask about the network, about reachability. So those three things together, we combine, we ask the automated theorem prover, and the automated theorem prover gives us the answer. And that has gone on to power Amazon Inspector and VPC Reachability Analyzer externally, and then we're using that internally in a number of use cases.
But there are other tools as well that the team are developing in the security space that we categorize under machine learning. What's the relationship between machine learning and automated reasoning?
There's two pieces to that, two answers to that. So GuardDuty and Macy are using automated reasoning in an interesting way, that when you have an intractably large space, so the set of all configurations of policies or networks, et cetera, you want to now ask, you know, are there routes through this complex network such that certain conditions can occur? And automated reasoning is a great way of doing that, because it reduces that to a proof. What we try and prove it's not possible. And when the proof fails, we find a path. And so GuardDuty and Macy and a number of internal tools are using it really as a way of querying the semantics of policies, of networks.
As I mentioned earlier, Byron has been working in this field for over 20 years, yet it is still emerging. So what is it about being at AWS and using the cloud that is now enabling innovation in the automatic reasoning field?
The scale of the cloud and the number of customers operating on the cloud was really exciting, because the other thing that I saw in the history of automated reasoning is that there was a little bit of a chicken and egg problem going on, where people weren't using the tools because the tools weren't available. But then the tools weren't available because people weren't realizing they needed the tools. So I needed to go to an organization that was operating at scale and also had the APIs at the right level of abstraction that we could sort of kick off things and take things to the next level. One of the things that really struck me early on was that the interaction between Amazon's customer obsession and the space of automated reasoning work super well together. And the reason is that automated reasoning is typically solving undecidable or intractable problems for which there can be no general solution. You have to make solutions that work for certain domains. And in that reality, you need to work as closely as possible with the customer that has the problem. And so in the university setting or other places I've been, the level of customer obsession wasn't there. And at Amazon, I right away was talking to customers, and they began asking for tools, and we began supplying them with the tools. So within, I think, 8 weeks, 16 weeks, we had a couple of prototype tools in the hands of some close customers that were nearby the office I was working in. And they began using those tools, liking them, asking for features, and actually working with other customers to make sure that Amazon understood the value of what we were doing. So that was really, really exciting.
As we continue to work with our customers to innovate and develop these new applications for automated reasoning, what kind of things could customers be thinking about implementing? What's on the horizon?
So I think an area where we're headed is that reasoning to show that controls hold can be performed with advanced, sophisticated, hard to understand automated reasoning tools that are operated in a difficult cloud stack, et cetera. But then the proofs that are produced are in a standard format, easily checkable, with easy to understand tools that the world has agreed on as the source of truth, that then we check. And so the auditor can run the simple tools, and the customer can produce the proofs, or a third or an independent provider can run the advanced tools to find this proof. I mean, there's a continuum of things that customers should be doing. So for sure, customers should turn on IAM Access Analyzer, and they should go to the console, IAM Access Analyzer console, and look at their resources in this, and what the resource policies are allowing and disallowing. They should take a look at VPC Reachability Analyzer. They should turn S3 block public access on. Those are three things. And then under customers are already benefiting from the work we're doing underneath the stack, you know, in EC2 and S3, et cetera. Forthcoming are, I believe, will be more advanced tools. So advanced customers are customers that are curious. It's probably worthwhile investigating what these techniques are, what these tools are, because I think some familiarity with the concepts of those tools will allow you to use the more the power user features of them. So, for example, with IMXS Analyzer, if you get into the APIs, there's extra things you can do that you can't do with the console. But to use those features, you need to understand a little bit more about some of the techniques. And I think that will be a trend in the future, that we release features that are super easy to use and help everyone. But for folks that have a little deeper understanding of symbolic reasoning or concepts of environment models, that they'll be able to do more and they'll be able to go deeper with the tools.
I'd like to thank Byron for joining us, feeding my curiosity and digging into some of the truly fascinating under-the-hood mechanics and applications of automatic reasoning. If you'd like to learn more about our guest, you can follow Byron on Twitter at Byron Cook. And if you'd like to learn more about the automatic reasoning work at AWS, we've included links in the description below. We'll see you next time. Now, go build.